Tonight on Free Minds TV, we'll be talking about Jack Kevorkian's death. We'll also be discussing the fact that police in some areas of the country don't like you to cheer at graduations or help your neighbors clean up after a disaster. Plus, an update on the second dance party that took place at the Jefferson Monument in Washington, D.C. Tonight on Free Minds TV.
We appreciate you tuning in to episode 208 of Free Minds TV, where we challenge you, the viewer, to think outside the box. With you, as always, is Toby.
And Nick.
Got a lot to get into today. We're going to be getting into the police cracking down on illegal cheering at graduation ceremonies, at least in certain parts of the country, as well as you mentioned, there's been a rash of tornadoes. And while this could be a time to bring communities together and neighbor helping neighbor, well, not if the government's in charge. It's only the licensed neighbors who can help, whatever that means. We'll be getting into that, as well as a whole lot of other stuff. We'll see how much we can get into. There's a lot that's been going on this past week. But first, we did promise an update on the dance parties, or the crackdown on dancing, that's been going on in Washington, D.C. at the Jefferson Memorial. Last week's show, we covered the story of about a half dozen dancers who went to protest a court ruling that said there was no dancing at the Jefferson Memorial. And so a bunch of them went there and silently danced, and, well, the police didn't really like that too much. They cracked down, they arrested people, and some of them a little bit brutally. Some of them were body slammed. Adam Kokesh from Adam vs. the Man. He was doing some dancing.
That's some good dancing right there.
It was some good dancing, and they didn't like that. They threw him to the ground. They roughed up a couple of people, you know, and just for silently, peacefully
dancing. I'm glad
they're
keep everybody safe. It looks like they're really keeping everyone safe.
Oh, yeah, and really being respectful for what Jefferson stood for. It's funny, you know, he really liked dancing. There's many quotes about Jefferson alluding to how he thought dancing was good. It was important, a way to express yourself, but the courts have ruled that thou shalt not express yourself at the Jefferson Memorial. This includes any signs, any protesting, any speeches inside the atrium there, and expressive dancing as well. And any kind of dancing can be expressive. So they cracked down, they arrested those people, cleared them right out. Also, of course, cleared out the press because you can't have cameras. Well, it did go viral. Millions of people watched what the DC police did. And thousands of them pledged to return to the Jefferson Memorial 1 week later on a Saturday at high noon to do some more illegal dancing. Well, not all thousands came, but hundreds did show up, and dozens upon dozens of them did decide to dance, and it was a little bit more successful than last time. Before talking about it, let's go ahead, let's show the clip.
Revolution, baby, but no slam dancing. That's posted. Please.
Uh-oh. They're closing the area.
Yeah, hey!
Keep moving, guys. Keep the line moving. Keep the line moving.
Let's go.
You gotta move,
wait,
sir.
Wait, punch these guys? I'm not gonna push my way through them. Forget that. That's your job.
Just turn around and walk. Keep the line moving, guys. Keep the line moving.
I can't go.
Let's go. Keep the line moving.
We're trying to get us out of here.
Keep the line moving. Why do we have to do this. Let's go.
Why do you have to attack
him? Why do you have to attack him? This is a public place.
No, I think it's really telling at the end there where you can hear the police officer there clearly frustrated and saying, why do you guys have to do this? Because they're not getting out fast enough. It's like, well, no. Why do you have to do this? Why do you need to shut down the Jefferson Memorial because people are dancing? Why do you need to clear out everybody, kick out all the news media, kick out all the dancers there because of dancing? Why? I mean, they got away with it for about 15 minutes, and then the police decided to shut everything down. So I guess there were 15 minutes of freedom in Washington, D.C. this week.
Well,
is this a success?
I mean,
at least they didn't brutally body slam anyone to the ground. I guess that's a little success. But then again, people left when they were asked to leave. There were just a lot of them, so it took them a while. If people decided to refuse to leave, they would have arrested them again. But then again, a lot of people are saying, well, it's not true civil disobedience because they didn't get arrested. Well, what's the point in Washington, D.C.? I think that's a good point, too. It's just getting worse. Is it almost, it's almost time to give up in Washington?
I think it is, at least politically. But, I mean, I think it was a good thing that people decided to make a point
definitely.
Here. And, you know, there is a lot of power in people saying no. People weren't body slammed. There weren't arrests taking place. They closed the monument and herded everybody out, but there's a lot of power when enough people say no, simply refuse to follow those orders. Well, then the police do have somewhat limited power. I mean, they can either crack down and really brutalize a few people to try to scare the rest away, like they do in Syria and Egypt, and sometimes here, or they can back off. Those are the two options they have, to be totally tyrannical or to back off when enough people say no together. So does sort of force an outcome. And that's what people did here, thankfully. The police, for the most part, backed off. I mean, they herded everybody out, but they showed a lot more restraint than the first time around.
Yep, but it's still not good news because it was still all shut down. So I'd say it's just as much bad news as good news because you still can't dance in the Jefferson Memorial. Freedom still seems to be dead in Washington, D.C. And looks like in many other parts of the United States as well. It's just we're on this slippery slope and we're sliding down ever faster. Before the show, we were talking, a few of us were talking about what can you do in Washington, D.C.? You can't take pictures anymore, of course. There were a few stories I thought about bringing in about people being arrested under provisions of the Patriot Act for illegally taking pictures, because you can't do that anymore. You can't stop in front of the White House and admire it. Got to keep walking. Can you even, there's sectioned off parts that you're not allowed to go down. Is this what the freest country in the world is supposed to look like? No, because we're not the freest country in the world, and like many others, we are governed by essentially by words that tell us we're free, and then we accept that and we pretend we're free because we're freest country. Yay, our liberties, our freedoms. Yet if you try to utilize any of them, if you try to express your freedoms in any way that the government dictates that is not okay, you'll get arrested or herded out like cattle with the threat of arrest at the barrel of a gun.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it's come to. It's unfortunate, but I mean, it still makes me angry when I watch clips like this, when you actually see the police response. But at this point, you know, it's the new normal, which is sad. We've gotten used to it, and now it doesn't outrage people anymore. So the government will get to push further. And I mean, where are you able to protest? It's not just Washington, D.C. either, Toby.
Nope.
In a lot of major metro areas, places like New York City, you can't protest anywhere without a permit. You need a permit to do something that's supposedly a right, even if you're not blocking traffic or anything like that. Just, you know, people expressing themselves or protesting, that's unsightly. It's not orderly.
Yeah.
So.
Well, we are going to be getting into some more people protesting a few different government policies from different parts of the U.S. in the second half of tonight's show. But first, it's by the time viewers are watching this, it's premiering. It's been almost a week. But I did think that we should touch on the death of Dr. Death, Mr. Kevorkian. He passed away last week, and we've talked about him on a few different shows, because when you're coming from a principled standpoint where you don't believe the government should be aggressing in everybody's lives and individuals own themselves, they own their own body, that's the principle we're taking here on this show, the libertarian philosophy of liberty here, where we own ourselves.
Yes.
One of those things, if you own yourself, you should be able to decide when you're all done with yourself.
Right.
So we talked about Kevorkian a lot. So, well, I think it's fitting that we do at least mention his legacy and mention the fact that he's peaced out. So,
and I don't think it's really a good idea to decide to be all done with yourself unless you've got a really good reason. I still maintain that you own yourself, but I'm just throwing that out there.
Of course.
If you're dying of cancer, then I definitely get your point. You know, if there's very little chance you're going to recover from a terminal disease, or in many cases there's really no chance, and, well, you decide you don't want to put up with the suffering anymore, I say that's your choice. That was Jack Kevorkian's position. He, for those of you who don't know who Jack Kevorkian is, he basically built suicide machines, or machines that would facilitate people committing suicide. And for most of the period, he said he assisted with 130 assisted suicides of gravely ill people. In most of those cases, he simply set up devices that would kill those people, but they still had to either flip a switch or, you know, turn the knob or whatever it was. So he set up a system that could kill somebody, but he didn't actually kill that person directly. Now he had, I think they said three acquittals and one mistrial. He was eventually convicted of second-degree murder for one of the suicides that he helped facilitate. And, well, he died.
Well, he broadcast that one on TV. Right. I think that's one of the reasons that he got convicted.
Well, he was very...
He broadcast on 60 Minutes.
You have to remember that in spite of the fact that he got out of some of these charges initially...
He was very vocal.
And he didn't show very much... I mean, he was very much, my position is right, I don't care what the law says. And he successfully managed to beat the charges that way. I think one time he showed up in costume to a couple of his trials, represented himself in one of his trials. You know, he did not really show very much respect for the court trying to enforce these laws that he disagreed with. And he was definitely somebody, you know, I think he advocated these ideas because he genuinely believed in them. People will argue whether he was really effective or not. As of now, only three states have effectively legalized assisted suicide, and Kevorkian's tactics were controversial. They were kind of a freak show in a way. I mean, he was killing people in the back of his creepy assisted suicide van, so didn't really put a good face on the whole euthanasia idea. But as of now, Oregon, Washington State, and a Montana Supreme Court ruling have effectively legalized practices of assisted suicide within certain limits in those states.
It seems,
so that's 3 out of 50.
It seems pretty crazy that it's not more. I mean, we recognize when an animal is on its last few weeks to live here. It's suffering. It's a humane thing to do is to put it down. And anyone who doesn't, we call them cruel. We call them heartless when they're letting this poor dog, for example, your pet that you love, you're letting it suffer through the last few weeks of its life when it's clearly all done. It's just in pain and suffering. Yet, we do. If it's too cruel to do to a dog, why do we do it to humans, people that we love, human beings? We cause them to needlessly suffer when they're all done. They're saying, please let me die with dignity. Nope, thou must suffer because you're a human,
well,
not a dog.
There is that religious aspect to it, which doesn't really do
okay,
much
worry
for me.
About yourself. The religious aspect also preaches the fact that you're not supposed to get in the business and judge other people.
Right. Yeah, depends.
So if you're going with
fewer people read that provision than the part
okay,
that says
I don't
you
care.
You
don't get to pick and choose. You take it or don't take it. Take it or leave it. You don't get to, oh, I like this scripture, but not that scripture.
Well, that's what most people do. Okay. But anyway, I mean, I don't know. Some people argue that if you're advocating euthanasia, then you're on the slippery slope to eugenics, which I really don't buy at all, because this whole idea is predicated on the idea of consent, the wishes of the dying person.
Right. Not saying go kill people who don't want to die.
Right. We're not saying, you know, if people have some defects, then we should do what the Nazis did. That's a different story. There's no consent involved there. But when you've got somebody who's, as you said, Toby, all done living, and there's not really much of a chance that they're going to get better either from a physical condition or from a mental health condition. And I think most people, you know, if they're not in their right mind, it would be a good idea to maybe keep them from killing themselves for a while. Because, you know, it's not just terminally ill people who try to kill themselves. If somebody's trying to kill themselves, ultimately there's only so much you can do.
Well, common sense should prevail, but...
Right.
If somebody
really wants to kill themselves, they're going to do it.
Well, you know, Nick, this whole debate, it's been skewed in so many different ways. For example, I think this is a good opportunity to bring up these so-called death panels that I've been hearing a lot of Tea Party members talking about, of what this new Obamacare legislation is doing. Now, I'm not any fan of Obamacare. leave it at that. I don't want to discuss the whole healthcare bill. But when I hear people talking about death panels and about how a panel of people are going to be decide who's living and dying, it just makes me mad because it's complete BS. It's people just straight up lying about what's actually in the bill. What these so-called death panels are, it's just setting up a conversation between an individual and their doctor saying, you've got a few months left to live. Do you really want to be spending thousands of dollars to try to keep you living and limping along a little bit longer, transplanting that heart or that liver that's not really going to keep you alive? Or would you like to take another option? Would you like to spend time with your family rather than going through this painful treatment process that's not really going to help? You know, it's just weighing the options. So we shy away from even that. We call those death panels, just having a conversation of options with your doctor. No, can't do that. That would be too controversial to have a conversation about your last few months of life if you're terminally ill or about to die. So there's some kind of, we have this fear of death in this society,
well,
and we like to twist things.
It's a fear of death to the point that, you know, people are more concerned with not dying than living well. And I think we see this with, as you're pointing out, Toby, especially with people at end of life, where, you know, if you're 90 years old and your heart is pretty much gone and you're suffering from congestive heart failure more and more often, does it make sense to do a heart transplant? No. You're 90 years old. It's over. Just let it go.
Yeah,
I mean, if you got the money to pay for it, go for it.
But Nick, it's not worth it because then your last few days of life are spent
on
an operating table in pain rather than spending time with your family.
Not to mention that heart goes to you as opposed to somebody that could really help.
On top of the high insurance, I mean, that's hundreds of thousands of dollars are wasted this way.
One of the biggest reasons why the healthcare costs are so high in this country is
that all the death panels are saying, let's open up a dialogue. They're not saying, let's force people to do it. Let's just say, let's give them the options. Let's have a conversation, a couple hours to talk.
I can't remember the figures, but I think it was something like a third or a half of healthcare costs. It was a significant proportion of it. Is spent on people in the last 6 to 12 months of life. So you're dealing with these situations where you're dying. And in many cases, it's clear that you're dying.
Yeah.
There's no real way to, you know, there are some conditions you can recover from. There are some cancers, for instance, that are fairly treatable. You know, there might be a survival rate of 50%. I'm not saying don't get treated. If you're 60 and there's a 50-50 shot, yeah, you should, in that position, I would probably go with the treatment. That's an individual choice. But I do think that people need to rethink this whole notion that we have of death and what it's worth doing to avoid it or to, you know, to prolong making
rather
that
than
decision
spend
for
my
another
last,
month or
let,
two.
Let the, here's my living will. Rather than spend the last few months of my life suffering through painful treatments and certain needless surgeries that I'm going to die anyways, I'd rather enjoy the last few months out of the hospital, okay? Let me die if I don't get the conversation with my doctor.
Sir, just throw a party.
Sure.
Raging party.
All right.
You have to worry about your health.
All right, we got more to get into. It looks like she does have a legacy, though, right? The Kevorkian. There's others.
There's a 91-year-old woman, speaking of people who are towards the end of their lives, a 91-year-old woman, Charlotte Heidorn. Apparently she's selling these suicide kits, which one guy apparently used. I don't know that he was terminally ill. Now, I think I think it's kind of silly that they're going after her because, frankly, these devices, according to the story here, are, they consist of clear plastic bags and medical-grade tubing. A customer places the bag over his head, connects the tubing of the bag to a helium tank, turns the valve, and breathes. So-called kit, suicide kit, asphyxiates the customer within minutes.
Well, they're going
you can
after
do that yourself. Yeah, I mean,
that's like saying
that's like selling
arresting someone
trash
for
bag.
Yeah, but you write bags on them.
Right.
If you write death bag on a trash bag, then you.
I mean,
go
we are talking about people choking themselves to death with plastic bags.
Yes, and helium.
Come on, the people who are doing this. I'm not saying I agree with what she's doing.
No.
However, I guess it was a 29-year-old in Eugene, Oregon, killed himself with one of these things. He was probably going to kill himself anyway. If he took the time to go online, order a kit, I mean, this isn't very, I mean, he could have just read what the kit was and made it himself. So I just don't think that her role in any of these deaths, even if people are killing themselves in droves with these devices, I would say that they would have killed themselves anyway, and the device isn't inherently dangerous unless you're suicidal.
Yeah, a hammer is dangerous if you're suicidal. This is a stake.
I mean, you kill yourself with a hammer, Toby.
Oh,
that's not a pretty picture.
It's happened, Nick. Anyway,
I'm sure it has.
I'm not trying to make too light about suicide.
No, suicide's
here.
A serious subject.
But you know what? Death is a serious subject, too, but it's time to start breaching it and open up the
dialogue.
Well,
we all die,
yeah.
Right?
Why are we so afraid to talk about it.
We all die.
It's silly. So. Maybe I'll feel differently when I'm old. Real old.
If you get there.
If I get there.
You might die tonight.
I might on the way home from this show. I'll never even get to post it. Anyways, we do need to move right along. We've got more stories to cover. I don't think we're going to get to them all. But I do want to get into cheering at graduation. Now, Nick, I never... I wasn't too much of a fan of graduations. I skipped my college one. As well as I believe my high school one. It was perfect attendance all 4 years of college, but didn't really, I mean high school, but never really wanted to go to graduations. I don't find them exciting, but some people do. Some people want to go and they want to shout and they want to cheer for their graduates. They're proud of this moment. But some school officials and some police, police officers out there, some departments, don't find it an occasion to cheer for joy. In fact, in Duncan, South Carolina, the police department has decided to issue people citations if they cheer too loudly.
Yeah.
Well, this started a few years ago where the Duncan Police Force decided that they would be escorting parents out who cheered for their children when they graduated. But when Duncan residents went civil disobedience in response, standing to cheer and then simply leaving the stadium on their own, the police got a little bit angry. In conjunction with school officials, they began stationing cops throughout the audience. Anyone who was witnessed in acts of illegal celebration was issued a ticket for disorderly conduct, which entails a fine of $262. This year, the cops busted 13 parents for nefarious cheering. And according to this blogger, then they all went home to the chief's home to watch The Sound of Music, during which they rooted loudly for the Nazis. So.
There are a lot.
Thou shalt not cheer.
It's actually, I mean, it's hyperbole to a point, but sometimes when we read stories like this, I don't think we're all that far off. The mentality that's there that you should be arresting parents
obey.
For cheering. Right, obey.
That's what
they're saying.
Saying obey. It's not about the cheering, Nick. It's definitely not about the cheering, because the cheering is not hurting a soul. What it's about is you're disobeying officials.
Right.
The officials say no, and you're doing it anyways. This is unacceptable. Let's arrest them. Give them criminal records.
Yeah.
Give them a fine. Bad. Thou shalt not. It's not about the cheering. The cheering's... Of course it's not about the cheering. It's about obeying.
Apparently people in the stands, it sounds like a lot of the parents were doing this.
Yeah.
And, you know, cheering then leaving after they decide to start escorting parents out. So the people who pay taxes, the people who the school system supposedly there to serve, seem to want to cheer when their kids graduate, as most normal people do. And this is a crime. This is a problem. It's up to the police to say. It's up to the superintendent of the school to say.
About obeying, Nick. Speaking of obeying.
You should just take people like that and dump them in the ocean.
Fine. All right.
One life preserver. One life preserver for like every three or four of them. I'm not saying kill anybody. I'm just saying put them in a situation where something might happen, much like Jack Kevorkian did.
All right, then. Well, on that note, let's move along to neighbors helping neighbors, Nick. Mm. Now, one thing I like about natural disasters is they can bring out the best in some people. They can cause people to really drop everything, quit making money, give their services out for free, help their neighbors, feed them, set up soup kitchens, or help them clear out brush or debris. Really, communities coming together. They can also bring out the worst in people where there's looting and stuff.
Although a lot of the stories about looting, for instance, with Hurricane Katrina, and that was one where there were a lot of reports of looting, they were overblown. For the most part, the looting didn't really happen. A lot of the looting was actually done by police departments and people working for the city. They commandeered a lot of things. But much of the looting that took place was actually people just going into the grocery stores and taking food that would have been thrown away anyway because... You know, the stores had lost electricity for weeks, so they were hungry. There was no food infrastructure to buy food. There were no stores open, so they fed themselves. I'm not calling that looting.
I'm not going to consider that looting. Either.
Looting is like when you start throwing bricks through windows and setting stuff on fire and
taking flat screen TVs.
Yeah, taking three or four flat screen TVs because your friends might want some too, and you might be able to sell them.
I think if you take one flat screen TV, Nick, it's still looting. You don't need a flat screen TV to stay alive for a few weeks until help arrives.
If the flat screen TV is going to get thrown away anyway, then it's okay.
It's not still looting.
Okay.
All right. Nick's morals.
It's not the means.
There's a gray area, a moral line of what's looting and what's not.
Yeah. Well,
anyways, this isn't a story about looting. This is actually a story about people helping each other.
Yeah. Yeah, well, there are people trying to help each other. Apparently, it didn't work out.
Well, it happened in Katrina, too, where Walmart, I think it was, tried to ship all this water to hurricane victims.
FEMA was turning it
and
around.
And FEMA was just turning away the water truck, saying, nope, that's not an official FEMA water truck. We can't have that here. You need to be licensed to give away this water.
Licenses are much more important than actually giving people water or clearing roadways to people that can move around. And that's one of the points, you know, one of the things in this country is that we've gotten to the point where it's more important to follow asinine rules than it is to actually get things done. I think that has a lot to do with the way that we respond to emergencies or don't these days, and I think it's caused a lot of other problems just in society in general, because you can't even focus on running your business without first focusing on being a compliant business and following all the regulations that are out there. So I don't think it's a good thing for society to be so overregulated. And it certainly wasn't in this case. This is a story coming out of Minneapolis, where a tornado did some damage recently. And Mike Haig's sister lived in North Minneapolis, and so he knows the neighborhood a little bit. And when a tornado tore through the area on May 22nd, he decided to go out and try to help. Now, he's licensed to do tree service in surrounding communities. He lives nearby in another town. And in some of these towns, he is licensed. He's actually a guy who's got a truck, he's got a chipper, he can clear trees that have been taken down by a storm. You know, get trees off of somebody's roof, when they've fallen because of storm damage, get them out of the road. Now, the problem wasn't that he was clearing trees. That's okay. The problem was that he did not have a license. And he went with...
Driver's license?
He did not have a license to clear trees.
Oh.
In Minneapolis. Oh. He had licenses in the nearby towns.
I didn't know you even needed licenses to clear trees
in Minneapolis,
anywhere.
You do.
That's silly.
And apparently, a city inspector told him to leave the scene, even though he was not charging for services. This was volunteer work following an emergency. He was trying to get trees out of the road and stuff. The homeowners wanted him to continue. They weren't concerned that he wasn't licensed. The city inspector claimed to believe that he was charging for services, even though the story here from the Hastings Star-Gazette says that the residents, in many cases, said that no, he was not charging for services. They backed him up. But the inspector ordered him to leave Minneapolis, and unbeknownst to him, sent a couple of police cars to follow him to make sure that he did leave. He said he was flagged down by residents on his way out of the city and was begged to clear some more trees out of the way, which he started to do. The police stopped him, held him there on the side of the road for a couple of hours, debated arresting him, then let him go. But apparently he's going to get hit with a fine. A ticket showed up for $275 from the city of Minneapolis.
Well,
thanks for your help.
Thank you, government, always helping out there,
I feel much better now.
And people say that we really need this bloated, big, fat government around
one
to keep
us safe. One life preserver.
God.
Only one.
Damn, it's pathetic. All right, that's going to do it for us. FreeMindsTV.com. Until next week, it's been Toby here with you.
And Nick.
Have a great week.